Okay. The fact that I'm standing here in front of this room means that you expect that I tell you something, that I give you some information. And I will do that, no worries about that. But I would ask you something in return, some information from you as well, such that we can have sometimes a two-directional flow. I will use some tools for that, because often, if, especially in small audiences, if you ask people, what is your opinion on this or that, you will get the politically correct answer. And I want to know your real opinions. So I will ask this in an anonymous way. The topic of the talk will be how quantum simulation methods can be used for the development of future TCOs. And that's actually a tandem talk with the one of Bart Partoons, who will be the next speaker. So I will cover the methodology part, and I will give one example for structural properties. Bart will then continue with electronic properties, and I guess also with high throughput applications. Now, right at the start, I would like to know what is the mood of this audience, so to guess what you expect. And think about the moment when you entered this room a few minutes ago. Which of these two statements applies best to your feeling at that moment? So, if you succeeded to connect, and I see 8 people got connected to that website, you can press the answer that applies best to you. And we have almost all answers, so now I'm very curious. Seems 1/3 was very excited and 2/3 were a bit reserved. So that means that I have some missionary work to do. Good to know. I was misleading you a little bit by asking exactly these two questions, because I used twice the word theory there. And that's not exactly true. And that will be my first point. The things I am doing, the things Bart is doing, is not theory. And in order to explain what it really is, we need to make some detour along a topic from philosophy of science. I want to define 3 important concepts: experiment, theory, and simulation. And I will do that with the example of electromagnetism. So think about the 18th century, when electromagnetism was being developed. That was the infancy stage of that field of physics. And when a field of science is in its infancy, then the 2 things that matter are experiments and theory. You have to collect a lot of facts, observations about electric phenomena, interactions between charges, the concept of a current. You have to observe nature, you have to do experiments. And simultaneously, you try to find some mathematical formalism that can connect these observations with each other. And in the beginning, that doesn't fit very well. Your new observations are contradicting your theory. So there is a dialogue for a while. But gradually, you are finding the right theory. And in electromagnetism, that was, for instance, when Maxwell's equations were finalized. When that happens, when you find more or less the robust theory for that field of physics, you come to the teenager stage of the field. And then the theory is more or less finished. That activity disappears. What matters then is still experiment and simulation, which means now you have to use that theory. You try to duplicate your experiments by equations. And you are finding more and more complex situations to test that theory and to verify whether it really reproduces experiment also in these difficult circumstances. If that proceeds well, if there is no major flaw in the theory detected, then a field of physics becomes mature, and then the only activity that is left is simulation. Still about classical electromagnetism, There is no experiment going on anymore in classical electromagnetism nowadays. That field is in the hands of engineers. They know Maxwell's equations, and if they want to build some device, well, they build it by these equations. And once they know that, well, this is the device we want to make, they make it right away. There is no experimental phase anymore. That's a signature of a mature field. So when I say that theory is not the word that applies here, it means that what we will be talking about is simulation. Simulation in the sense that I have just explained. And that's a very powerful activity. I want to spend a few minutes by demonstrating how powerful simulation can be. And I do that by reproducing a historical experiment that is so simple that we even don't realize any longer that it is an experiment. But it has defied the brightest minds of humanity for 3 millennia. And that's the question: if I take a small object, a point mass, and I let it fall until it touches the ground, well, how much time does that take? This very simple experiment. For 3,000 years, people were not able to give a good rationalization of that question. Calculate the time it takes for this object to touch the ground. Well, if we look at that with our modern minds, we don't find this is a difficult problem anymore, because we know the underlying theory. We know classical mechanics. So we know that we can start from a limited set of very basic equations, Newton's law. So I've put Newton's law there. We run it through a mathematical machinery, calculus, and we get at the end of this calculation, which is actually a simulation now, at the end of the simulation, we get an expression that exactly predicts the time that this object needs to touch the ground. That activity is so powerful that you don't even need to repeat that experiment any longer. You can, without doing the experiment, predict right away how long that object will take to fall. And it's that kind of reasoning that we would like to replicate for condensed matter physics. What would be the basic equation where you start from if you want to do such a machinery for condensed matter physics? I wait for the answer. What is the fundamental equation that underlies all behavior of matter? The Schrödinger equation. So we have to start from the Schrödinger equation, which is at the same footing of Newton's laws. We have to run that through a mathematical machinery, which is slightly more complicated, so you can't do it on pen and paper. You will probably need a computer for that. And from this process, you extract all observable properties of matter without having to do any experiment. That's the idea. But we have to be able to solve Schrödinger's equation. So let's look how we can do that. What are the methods to solve Schrödinger's equation? I will explain it by a story. If you look at this picture, this is a picture made during the construction of the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider in CERN. A gigantic machine, just to illustrate the size of one detector of that machine. Look at this human being here in the front. So a very complex project, budget-wise, people-wise, technology-wise, enormously complex. And let's do a thought experiment. Imagine that you are the manager who has to oversee that entire project. If you are in the position of such a manager, you will be contacted by a special kind of people, business consultants. And one day, a consultancy company enters your office. The company has the name TDF, the Delusion Factory, and they make you an interesting proposal. They tell you, well, at our company we have developed a protocol by which we can transform any complicated experiment into something very simple. With your LHC, you want to measure the mass of the Higgs boson. Well, if we apply our protocol, we can translate your machine into a very simple electric circuit. And if you take your voltmeter and you connect it here and here, the reading you will get in volt will be the mass of the Higgs boson in, say, giga electron volt. I guess if you are really the manager, you will kick these people out of your office. And of course, the story is a little bit exaggerated. But if you understand this story, then you understand the reasoning by which we can solve the Schrödinger equation. Because I will now replicate the story, but apply it to the Schrödinger equation. The Schrödinger equation is as complex as building the LHC. So we start from something enormously complicated. The equivalent of that consultancy company, TDF, is DFT, Density Functional Theory. And DFT does exactly what that company promised to the manager. It promises to convert that very complicated Schrödinger equation into something that is trivially to solve, the Cohn-Sham equations. You don't have to mind what the Cohn-Sham equations are, but they are single particle equations, single particle differential equations that people nowadays can solve without any problem. That is an almost trivial equation to solve. So we have many methods that can do that. They go by names as LAPW, PAW. These methods are implemented in computer codes that go by names as VASP or Wien2K or Quantum Espresso. So there is an entire market around this. These things are under control. We can solve Cohn-Sham equations perfectly. And in this way, the solutions of the Cohn-Sham equations, they are exactly equivalent to the solutions of the Schrödinger equation. So in this way, we can get the solution of the Schrödinger equation. We can predict anything we want about the solid. That sounds too good to be true. And there is somewhere a catch, indeed. Density functional theory can do that conversion, provided you know one single mathematical object, the exchange correlation functional. You don't have to care what that object is, but there is somewhere out there just one single mathematical object. If you would know it, then you can predict all properties of all solids once and for all. And the problem is, we don't know that mathematical object. We have to make a guess for the exchange correlation functional. And once that guess is made, then we can apply these solution methods. But as the guess is probably not exact, there will be an error bar on our predicted results. It's completely comparable to the situation of the electrical circuit. It would be as if that consultancy company tells you, well, we have the protocol to make that conversion, but there is one resistor in our circuit for which we don't know the value of the resistor. So we have to guess which resistor we put there. And that will, of course, compromise the reading on your voltmeter. That is the idea behind density functional theory. That is the method that, well, say 90% of the simulation work on solids and materials nowadays is using. The next question is then, how good does that method perform once we have made that guess for the exchange correlation functional? What is the precision? What is the accuracy of density functional theory? And I've used in my previous sentence two words, precision and accuracy, that need to be well defined in order to evaluate the performance of DFT. So let's spend another story to defining what I mean by precision and accuracy. Let's go back to the ancient China. And you wonder, what is the height of the emperor of China? That's not a simple question to answer, because hardly anybody has ever seen the emperor of China. This person lives in the Forbidden City, closed from the view by any normal Chinese. Even the people of his entourage who are allowed to see the emperor are very, very limited. So it's very hard to have an idea how tall this person would be. But there is a method to know that precisely. You go around China, you travel through China, and every person you meet, you ask his or her opinion. How tall do you think the emperor would be? And you ask this to 100,000 Chinese. You make a histogram out of that, that might look like this, and you take the average of that histogram, which in this case would be something like 1.78 and something meters. If you do that for 100,000 people, the statistical uncertainty on that number would be about 0.1 millimeter. And that is what I mean by precision. This method is precise up to 0.1 millimeter. And that means if you would travel again through China and ask another 100,000 people about their opinion on the height of the emperor, you would get the same number within 0.1 millimeter. Statistics guarantees that to you. Is that number accurate? Very likely not, because these people have no clue how tall the emperor is. So if you would be able to measure the real height of the emperor, you would perhaps find that number there, 1.66. And that is then the meaning of accuracy. Our very precise method was quite inaccurate. So these are the two concepts that we have to discuss if we want to evaluate how well density functional theory performs. How precise is it? And how accurate is it? These things are often confused. That leads to misunderstanding. And that's why I spent some time to define them properly. So how precise is our current implementation of density functional theory? If we ask that for a numerical method for a computer code, then the meaning of precision is the following. If we gave the same task to two independent methods or two independent implementations of one method, we expect to get the same answer. That is illustrated here with these two calculators that hopefully, probably will both give the result of two to that simple sum. But we can apply exactly the same question to density functional theory codes. We take a benchmark set of materials. We let two codes independently predict properties of these materials. And then we hope to find, in the end, the same sets of answers. Which benchmark sets do you take? Well, you have many choices, but we like to play with the elemental solids. So for every element of the periodic table, you take the crystal structure, that is the ground state crystal structure for that element. And so you have in this set here 71 elements, 71 elemental solids for which you will make predictions. You run that through two codes, and I take here two common examples. The VASP code at the left, which uses the PAW method, and the Wien2K code at the right, which uses the LAPW method, both accurate and standard DFT implementations, and we apply them to FCC copper. And what you see here in these two graphs is the total energy, so the internal energy inside the unit cell of FCC copper, as a function of the volume of the unit cell, here expressed as volume per atom in cubic angstrom. You get two of these curves for one of each of the codes, and the volume where the curve reaches its minimum, that is the equilibrium volume of FCC copper. So that is the volume that the unit cell would adopt according to DFT at zero Kelvin. So you can trivially get the lattice parameter out of that. So if we apply this for these two codes, if you fit an equation of state through that to accurately determine the minimum, you get an equilibrium volume of 12.03 cubic angstrom per atom for the VASP code and 12.02 cubic angstrom per atom for the Wien-2K code, which is, apart from some numerical noise, almost identical. That is for FCC copper. You can repeat that for all 71 materials in this test set. And if you plot the two sets of volumes with respect to each other, you get something that is nearly on the 45 degrees line. So indeed, these two codes predict really the same values for that property. We have elaborated on that idea. So we have converted that information into a metric, a single number that captures not only the equilibrium volume, but also other properties that depend on this energy versus volume curve, in order to measure everything at once. And we can make now lists of codes. So you see here a set of DFT codes that all have run that same benchmark for 71 elements, measure that metric, which we call delta, average over all elements of the set, and then you get a single number that determines how one of these codes deviates from a reference set of calculations. So right now, several groups are independently running the same benchmark for the codes they have developed. We are collecting these results, and we hope within the next year to be able to present a community-wide comparison of all DFT codes that are currently used. The list is continuously updated, so if you go to that website here, you will see the present snapshot. That is precision. So I can, just as a general evaluation, I can assure you that all these numbers here, these delta values, are very, very small. In practice, this means that all the codes that are displayed here will indeed produce the same result. These DFT codes are very precise. Accuracy, the other aspect. How well does DFT perform in terms of accuracy? Or more exactly, how well do our current guesses for the exchange correlation functional perform in terms of accuracy? And I have been talking too long. I should ask you a question now. I want to know which accuracy you would expect from DFT. I've taken a random material, scandium palladium, and that takes the cesium chloride structure. So that's a BCC structure, but with, say, scandium on the corners of the cube and palladium in the center of the cube. It's a material that exists, and probably you've never ever met it. I didn't either. And I ask you, if I give that material to someone who can do a DFT simulation, and you ask that person to predict the lattice parameter of that material in this crystal structure, what would be the deviation you expect that the answer of this person would have? Would this person be able to say, well, that lattice parameter is about 6 angstrom with an uncertainty of 5 angstrom? Or is it 6.6 angstrom with an uncertainty of 5 on the last digit? Or 6.61 with an uncertainty of 5 on the last digit, or 6.613 with that same uncertainty. What would you personally expect as accuracy for DFT? So that is the question that should appear on your screen. A, B, C, or D. There is no wrong answer. I'm not interested in the right answer. I'm interested in your opinion. Just to be able to see what the experimental community expects from DFT. And the results range from people who think DFT is a very, very lousy method. Half of the people think it's in the second digit, and there is nobody that thinks that it is in the third digit. Well, the correct answer is indeed C, which is what one half of you was thinking. DFT is able to predict lattice parameters with an accuracy that goes to the second digit. The uncertainty is in the second digit, which is equivalent to dropping our point mass, predicting the time. Here we predict the lattice parameter and the error bar is in the second digit. So here we go back to the equilibrium volume. Now for all 71 elements of that same benchmark set, and I plot the calculated equilibrium volume on the horizontal axis and the experimental equilibrium volume on the vertical axis. If that functional would be entirely accurate, then all points would again be on the 45 degrees line. And you see that for many solids, they are. But for a few solids, the ones that are marked here by white symbols, they are deviating from that line. So for these particular solids, that exchange correlation functional would make a wrong prediction for the lattice parameter. And that illustrates a typical situation. The solids which you see there are the noble gases and the van der Waals bond solids. And that is a type of bonding that this particular functional cannot describe well. If you have ionic materials, covalent materials, metals, there it works. For these other ones, it doesn't. So that's the responsibility of a user of DFT. You have to make sure in advance that the functional which you choose is appropriate for the property and the type of solid that you want to describe. If you make the right choice, your results will be sufficiently accurate. If you make the wrong choice, then you will produce lousy predictions. So to wrap that up, precision, that is something that is completely under control. Every standard DFT code, if it is used in the right way, should produce the same numbers. And that's the responsibility of the researchers that use that code to make sure that they really produce numerically meaningful results. If as an experimentalist you read a DFT paper and you don't see somewhere a computational section where sufficient tests are described that can convince you that this result has the right numerical accuracy, then feel free to neglect that paper. Because really, computational researchers should make sure that the numerical stability is reached. For the accuracy, it's different. There, you are just limited by what your functional can give you. But still, as a researcher, you have the responsibility to select as good as you can the right functional for the right property and right material. Let's now move back to TCOs. Applying density functional theory for development of TCOs. Let me describe the situation in which we were a few years ago, because we are personally, in our group, we are no experts on TCOs. We know these computational tools, but we are blind about TCOs. And we got the question in a project with experimental partners that were interested in TCOs to collaborate. So our situation was that we have at our side the DFT world where everything is fine and under control, single crystals, controlled impurities, we know which kind of errors we expect. And at the other side, we have that experimental community, the real world with the dirty materials, where you can have imperfections of all kinds that you don't have under control. And now we have to collaborate, to use the notorious Hardy quote, "Why don't you do something to help me?" set by the experimental community to the DFT community. That's a moment when you scratch your head, because that's an important stage. You should find the right thing to calculate, the right thing that you can calculate, and that helps your experimental partner. And that's not easy. I've, over the years, been involved in different of these collaboration projects, sometimes successful, sometimes unsuccessful. And if I look back and ask myself the ones that were not successful, where do they fail? Well, then it's exactly at this stage. They fail because we were not able to find a common ground, to find a right property that we can calculate with sufficient accuracy and that is meaningful, that gives new information relevant for the experimental partner. So talking to each other, that is really the issue. If you fail to talk, then you can use this other quote. It then becomes really a mess. Let me give you some examples of situations where it can fail, mistakes that people commonly make. And one common mistake is that in all these calculations, however accurate they are, you still calculate model systems. You calculate a single perfect crystal. There is no single perfect crystal in nature. Or you model one isolated defect. There is never one isolated defect in your sample. So you always calculate a model system. And if from the experimental side people think that that model is the real thing, you get misunderstandings. A second common problem is that people expect too much too fast. Getting this common ground, really understanding each other, can take years. Never go to a simulation person for a quick win. If you want to collaborate between theory and experiment, you should set out for a project that goes for over several years so that you have the time to understand each other. If you want to do it too fast, you get into that mess. And if there is one general rule of a question that can help you to find that common ground, then I would say it's this one. Search for a property that is easy to compute but hard to measure, and the other way around. These are the two aspects on which you can meet each other. Finding the easy things in one method that are not so easy to do experimentally. And the example I will show will follow that guideline. So the example will be about aluminum-doped zinc oxide, and well, more specifically for structural properties of that system. Let me explain the situation, the problem, as we understood it a few years ago by discussing with experimental people, by looking at the literature. So we have this ternary phase diagram of aluminum, oxygen, and zinc, where here, halfway between zinc and oxygen, we have our famous zinc oxide. And we want to make a TCO out of that by doping it with aluminum. For every aluminum atom you add, you have an extra charge carrier, so you gain conductivity. And if people add more and more aluminum, you see initially that the conductivity indeed improves, but beyond a certain aluminum concentration, it drops again. The question was, why does it drop? And then, what can we do to avoid that dropping? A hypothesis at that time in the literature was the conductivity drops because you start growing another crystal structure that is not zinc oxygen with substitutional or interstitial aluminum anymore, but really a different crystal structure that intrinsically has a lower conductivity. So that was the situation that we tried to examine from the computational side. Let me be a bit more specific about where in the phase diagram we want to work, because if you just add aluminum to zinc oxide, you are violating the equilibrium of oxidation states. You cannot just insert or replace a zinc atom by an aluminum atom because these are two different oxidation states. You will have to add some extra oxygen as well. And if you search for the geometric place in the phase diagram where you keep the balance between the oxidation states, you see that you are covering a straight line that connects zinc oxygen with aluminum 203. So all element, all materials that are along that line are combinations of these two end materials. And there is even a known mineral, gunite, which is on that same line. The people who have studied that question before us had used DFT as well. And our most important starting point was a paper by Yoshioka and co-workers that appeared in Journal of Applied Physics in 2008. And they had a hypothesis for that newly precipitated phase with lower conductivity. They claimed it could be nanolaminated zinc 3 aluminum 2 O6, which is, if you look back to the formula on the previous slide, is the one where X equals 3 and Y equals 1. So you take 3 units of zinc oxygen, 1 unit of aluminum 2O3, mix them together, and you get something with that stoichiometry zinc 3 aluminum 2O6. They have to find an ID for the crystal structure of that material, and that doesn't come spontaneously from DFT. So they looked around to other material systems and looked which crystal structures appear there. And they noticed that if you mix indium oxide with aluminum oxide, and that phase diagram is better known, and there was a crystal there which they call the homologous phase, or this nanolaminated phase, so the phase with that structure here, that appeared in that phase diagram. So they made the hypothesis, let's assume that that same phase would also exist in the zinc oxygen aluminum oxygen phase diagram. Would that be consistent with experiment? Well, let me first describe how that crystal structure looks like. They call it nanolaminated for a good reason. So you have regions here in red of aluminum oxygen, and this is just two atomic layers wide, separated by slabs of zinc oxygen doped by 25% of aluminum. And that is repeated. Why do they think that this is an acceptable crystal structure for this material? Well, they have several arguments. They calculate by DFT the formation energy. So if you mix the zinc oxygen and the aluminum oxide, how much energy do you have to add in order to be able to stabilize that structure? And that turned out to be about 1.3 electron volt per atom, which is a positive value. So this is a metastable phase. It doesn't form spontaneously. You have to add this energy in order to create it. But that energy is lower than any other suggestion that had been made before in the literature. So in that sense, it's the best structure they could propose. Another experimental fact, if you make that structure, it expands in the C direction with respect to zinc oxygen. And that was in agreement with experiment. In experimental samples that were doped by that amount of aluminum also expand in the C direction. If you would just put the aluminum substitutionally, the expansion would not be there. So that is a strong argument. And a third one is they made Xanis experiments and also simulations for Xanis spectra. And you see here in red the experimental spectrum for a sample doped with that amount of aluminum and the simulation for that nanolaminated phase. And, well, I'm not a Xanis expert, but they told that this is in reasonable agreement. If you would take the Xanis spectrum of just substitutional aluminum and zinc oxygen, it would look totally different. That was published in 2008. That was picked up by the experimental community. And 2 years later, you find an APL where in the abstract people say, well, we have done Xanis again with high statistics. And we observe that homologous phase, that nanolaminated phase, in our samples. they didn't really observe that, because from Xanis you don't get the structure, but I find a spectrum that is comparable with the one I showed on the previous slide. So, and then the reasoning goes, theory has predicted that this is the crystal structure that should be there, and we see a compatible Xanis spectrum, so that structure will indeed be there. But we still have that guess for the crystal structure. That was only a guess. It appeared in the indium oxide phase diagram. Nobody guarantees that it will appear in this phase diagram here. So you need better methods to really predict the crystal structure. And that is where our work came in. We used not bare DFT on a hypothetical or proposed crystal structure. We used DFT in combination with an evolutionary algorithm. So an algorithm where you start from a random set of crystal structures, and random is really random. You take a unit cell that has random shape and size, and you randomly put the proper amount of atoms inside, calculate the total energy, and do this for a few hundred crystals. Then you take the one with the best total energy, cut them in two, glue them together to have a child from parents, calculate the total energy again. And hopefully they will inherit the low total energy from their parents. And this goes on for a few generations until you converge to a generation that has a crystal structure with a very, very low, the lowest possible total energy. And that will probably be very different from the random sets where you started from. I have a small demonstration that some people in this audience have seen already before. It's the illustration of a genetic algorithm, of an evolutionary algorithm for two-dimensional cars. So the goal is build a car with the objects you see there that runs as far as possible over a given track. And now the first generation is being constructed, just random cars, and most of them doesn't do anything at all. There can be very funny random examples. They break. This one goes at least a meter. Sometimes you see cars without wheels and so on. So the first generation has passed. Now it starts the second generation. It will combine features of the best cars of the previous generation. And that goes on. And I've started that simulation just before the talk started. So let's look at how it is about after 1 hour of evolution. And then you see that there are already much more decent cars. So this one is driving quite a distance over that track. Let's just follow it until it fails. It's already very clever. Really clever. For human engineers, it's then the question, why does these things work as good as they do? Okay, it's too good. I will leave it alone because otherwise we run out of time. So that idea of an evolutionary algorithm we apply to our crystals. And we find the following solution. So I compare here at the left that nanolaminated zinc 3 aluminum 2 oxygen 6 with the structure we found after the evolutionary algorithm. And what we find now is in blue regions of the composition of zinc oxygen. So there is no aluminum anymore in the blue regions. And there are wires of just a few atoms thick in red that are aluminum 203 wires. So you have a fabric of zinc oxygen bulk penetrated by aluminum 2 oxygen 3 wires. A very different crystal structure that has a formation energy that is lower than the one of the nanolaminated structure, that also expands in the C direction, just as the nanolaminated structure and just as experiment does, and that has a Xanes spectrum here in red that is not in perfect agreement with the black experimental spectrum, but that certainly doesn't deviate more than the dashed spectrum here, which was the one for the nanolaminated spectrum. So in our opinion, all these, it is as consistent with experiment as the nanolaminated structure, but it has a lower energy according to DFT, so it should be even better. That's what we think. I don't know what you think, so let me ask it. Are you convinced by these arguments or not? What is, after this explanation, after having seen my evidence, what is your opinion? Did I convince you or not? What is the ground state crystal structure of zinc 3 aluminum 206, nanolaminated or nanofabric? And it's quite split. So some 40% of the people are not convinced that it should be a nanofabric, and then I will be very interested in the next break or after this talk to hear the arguments of these people. That could be very interesting. So at least the editors of Christenscom were convinced by our arguments. So that paper appeared, I think, last year, where we were happy to put one of my children on the cover page. And now his two brothers are asking me, when will you publish a paper with me on the cover page? So that's still a family discussion we have to settle. I'm almost done. The last thing I want to know is how well you understood the messages I try to convey. Not to test you, but to test me. So we will do a last activity, which is a little space race. I take a quiz that I prepared for this. Let's see, the audience, well, can be divided in three teams. You will see randomly a color on your screen, just in text, and you will get three questions that have to be answered by true or false. Three questions that can't be answered with the messages that I try to give to you. And we will see how the teams behave with respect to each other. And the farther these rockets go to the right, the better I succeeded in making my point. Let's see. You will not see whether your answer is right or wrong, but that can be food for the coffee break afterwards. Blue and lime are competing. Whoops, every team. All people in the blue team have answered perfectly. Yeah. I'm happy. It seems that the messages did indeed come across. Okay, let's wrap up. So I try to explain what is the difference between experiment theory and simulation, and try to give you the message that what many people call theoretical physics is actually simulation. We looked at density functional theory and at its accuracy and precision. I stressed the importance of very deep communication between experiment and simulation in order to make progress. And I illustrated this with a structural property of this crystal structure of an aluminum-doped zinc oxide. If you want to have the slides of this presentation, you can go either to that address or scan that QR code. And the talk has been recorded, so in 24 hours you will find it on YouTube. The address where you find it is contained in these slides. Thanks for your attention, and I'm ready to answer your questions.